Hello, 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 people. Good morning. Thank you for tuning in to Choco Melanin. How are you doing? Good morning. It's 6, almost 7 a.m. here, Eastern Time Zone, Canada, Ontario. This is yours truly, Choco Melanin. Yours truly, Choco Melanin. Wow. I have a gentleman seated right here. He has been with me for the last 30 minutes, maybe, I guess.
Yes, yes.
It's actually my first time seeing him. My first time, let me use this opportunity to acknowledge Omolola Anifowose. Odunlade, this is your first time here. I want to acknowledge you for tuning in. God bless you. Tag a friend, tag somebody, share on your pages, share on social media. Please promote this platform. We want to empower people to do things. We want to empower the people who are down there. And I cannot do this without you. This is something, trust me. If I look at the impact the videos are having on people, it's not even about me. It's about what it's doing to people. So you and I have a responsibility to reach out to our people. Many of our people are trapped in different circumstances. And sometimes we need one of our own to give a voice to people. Good morning to you, Professor Dr. Jones Opoku-Ware from KNUST, criminologist from KNUST. I see you watching as well. God bless you for tuning in this morning. Josh Pobi from Choco, I greet you as well. All right, so I have this gentleman with me. He's been with me for the last 30 minutes. In fact, it's my first time meeting him, my first time ever. Mm-hmm. Yeah, if you want to use a washroom, great. Otherwise, you can sit down, just have your time. In fact, today I have two Nigerians in my house, and you cannot miss this video. Don't miss this video. Ask somebody to come and watch it. Mm-hmm. Or their story will inspire you, even if you are not interested in a visa. If you are not interested in getting a visa to go somewhere and you want to stay in Africa, at least their story will inspire you. Barros, Josh, Kimish, Pam, how are you doing, sir? How are you doing? How are you doing? Bakari, Abdul, Wasiu, good morning to you. Good morning to you. Samuel Bismarck, Nikwe, Mingabu, 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 Mino Magbelebu, Nkefitaye. All right, so yesterday, around maybe 10 p.m., 11 p.m., there about one Nigerian contacted and then said, I want to see you desperately. I said, all right. So hooked them up. And he got here all the way from Toronto. He's been in the country for probably about 1 week. Came on a visitor's visa to attend a conference. To attend a conference. So you guys are noticing the trend. A visitor's visa, no family member, no, just to attend a conference. Hooked up with me, and he's here. He has been sleeping since he just woke up, actually. We are in the basement apartment, by the way. Those of you who are familiar with this house, you know, right now we are in the basement apartment. And he just woke up. So that was the first Nigerian that came last night around 11 p.m. Now, just this morning, 30 minutes ago, another Nigerian just came in the same storyline. He also came here with a visitor's visa for how many days, sir?
Yeah.
How many days have you been here now?
5 days.
You've been
one
here?
Week.
For one week.
Yes.
So both of you, one week. Different flight. You didn't use the same.
No.
You can sit on that side there.
Different flight.
Yeah. And I've decided not to show their faces because these people are on a mission. They're on a mission. So I'm not going to show you their faces. They are here to explore Canada, to tour Canada, to see the wonders of Canada. And they haven't finished seeing it, so they won't show their face to you. Okay? So, aside from the gentleman that came, okay, you came here yesterday. You came to see me yesterday.
Yes, yesterday.
What we came around, was it 10 p.m.?
Yeah, we came around 10 p.m.
And it's your first time meeting me?
Yes.
And you came from the Toronto, you were in a hotel, you were lodging in a hotel in Toronto.
Yes.
You came with what visa?
Visitors visa.
To do what? To attend a conference. Thank you, there. All right. Which part of Nigeria? The state. Which state?
I'm from Imo State.
Imo State.
Yes.
I hear you. All right. Good, 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 good. All right. So that is an Imo State man. On my side that my hand is pointing at. Those of you who can decode the voice spiritually, you know, you cannot decode it, you need a gift of discernment. Then on my left hand side here is another Nigerian. They don't know each other. They've never met before until the last 5-10 minutes or so. And aside from the first Nigerian that came to see me 10 p.m. there about yesterday, for the first time, we've never met.
Yeah.
Just reach out to me like that. The other Nigerian to the same. In fact, he also reached out to me and said, you know what? I'm coming to Canada. And for those of you who are my subscribers on my Facebook, you know there are people who subscribe to my Facebook, they are monthly subscribers. So it is actually one of our monthly subscribers from my Facebook page who is here. And he called. We've been talking and he said, you know what, I also need to see you desperately. I said, okay. And we're talking. From Toronto to come here with Uber is a bit pricier because my place is about 1.5 and Uber guys will... But this man passed through the darkness like that. I was sleeping, you know. You can see I haven't even freshened my face. I was sleeping and then he just called me and said, man, I'm close. I'm very, very close to your house. I said, how did you come here? He said, I came with taxi. I said, okay. And the taxi driver that dropped you is from which country?
Ghana.
Wow. So, Mr. Adamu.
Yes.
Mr. Right. Adamu, taxi driver from Ghana, Takoradi. You mentioned that you are from Takoradi. And a very elderly man. You work around the Kipling line there in Etobicoke.
Yes.
I spoke with you not too long ago. God bless you, Daddy, for bringing our brother here safely. God bless you. God bless you, Mr. Adamu from Takoradi, who is... The taxi driver that brought this gentleman here. Gentlemen, welcome to Canada.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So
thank you.
You both have been here for about 1 week or so.
Yes.
Okay. You've been in a hotel most of the time.
Yeah.
That money where Buhari give you, when they come here, all the finish, hotel will finish up. Hotel will finish all. Yes, yes, yes. And you've been lucky to crash into a place where...
Yes.
Yeah. Serious. In fact, when you came, you couldn't find an accommodation, so you had to...
No, first day, I stayed at a hostel.
A hostel, okay.
Yes, at Quebec. So before I moved down to Toronto, then there I met one Nigerian guy that I know before. Then I talked to him. So the guy just, okay, let me help you out. Let me see what we can do. So he took me to one place then.
You're crushing him.
Yes, sir.
Nice, so, nice, nice.
So staying there.
Yeah, the humble beginnings, no be so.
Yeah, not so.
So, which part of Nigeria you are from? Ondo State.
Yeah, I'm from Ondo State, but originally I'm from Kogi, but I grew up in Ondo State.
So you're originally from Kogi, but you grew up in Ondo State.
Yes.
Which city, is to be specific?
They call the city Magungu.
Wow.
Gungu.
Can you guys catch that?
That's my hometown.
That's his hometown.
Yes.
Okay. Is it rich people hometown?
No, no. Small village. Very.
Why you make like reverse? This small question where I ask you change your face like that.
Rich people don't deal.
Ibo Kwenu. My Ibo people in the house, I greet all of you there.
But generally, I'll be Yoruba guy.
Sure. All right. You are Yoruba guy.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yoruba. And you are an Ibo.
Guy.
So we have a Yoruba and an Ibo man here. Yeah. It's one love. You see, same destiny, same struggle.
Yes.
Same destiny. So, Sally, Ben, Munir, I greet you for tuning in. Sally, Ben, Munir, God bless you. All right. You didn't know each other. You guys just got to know each other some few minutes ago.
Yes.
But I'm pretty sure the struggles are the same wherever we're from. Are you guys? Are you guys rich kids?
No, you're not rich kids.
But if I watch your voice sounds like a rich man's smile.
And the face, you know,
they say Igbo people get a bit of money. So are you one of the anyway?
I'm so.
voice.
Don't mind the voice. He's a hustler. A hustler with a deep, rich people voice, you know? It means he's not born to be, he's not meant to be a hustler. It's supposed to be. Yeah. Greetings from South Africa. Mm-hmm. Sorry, greetings from South Korea. This is from Umar Ibn Abdullah. Thank you so much. Wumpini, Nowhere Upon. How are you doing, Wumpini? My regards to you. There, God lost me, Jerry. All of you there. Ways, sir. Ways Digital, all the way from Abuja. I salute you. And then I could see a special auntie there. God bless you. Asem Ilupo, God bless all of you there. Mm-hmm. Ogori Mangongo, local government.
Yes.
Somebody is giving the code. It means Mr. Ilupo knows the area very well.
Our small village. If you are going from Lagos to Abuja, you have to pass through my village.
Mangongo. Nice.
You have to pass through. So many people know the village.
I see. Yeah. All right. So I don't even know who to start with. Let's start with you. So is it your first time coming to Canada, Mr. Imo State?
Yes.
Your first time here?
First time.
Good. And you choose to come around the time that the weather is changing from summer, we are now cold. How do you find it here, cold?
It's been I think the weather is somewhat harsh. It's very cold.
Mm-hmm.
But I learned that winter is not here yet.
No. This one is a preview.
Ooh.
It's a preview.
I'm even scared.
It's like the air conditioning that's
Because the little I've seen is the thing changed my system. I've been coughing and I just had fever because of the cold. Then if I step out of the hotel, maybe want to go out, I step out, I'll feel like I'm entering into a deep freezer and I'll run back. You know? it was a very terrible thing. But my system is beginning to
acclimatize much more. So that one way, if you come out of your hotel and you're stepping out and you begin to feel cold, are you sure you're not missing your wife? Is it not your wife that you are missing?
It's part of it.
Oh my goodness, so funny. Stella Joel, first time watching Stella Joel. Welcome to Choco Melonia, Stella Joel. All right, so the weather, definitely when I came here the first time, I also felt like that. I came in August, and even around that time, I thought it was cold. They said it was so nice. They were wearing singlet and stuff. I said, but as time goes on, you begin to get used to it. Your body gets to adapt a bit. So it's normal. It's normal. When my wife came here the first time, she was dressed as if they did a good burial, covering up like that. But now, when you talk to her yesterday, what did she say?
Yes.
When you talk to her, she said yesterday was one of the nicest
weather.
And then you were like, no, it's cold. Like, but she forgot when she came here, she was also. So very soon, you'll be the one to tell people or give people weather update, you understand?
Sure.
Yeah, okay. And so this is your first time in Canada.
Yes.
How do you see the place so far?
Well, the day we entered Canada, immediately I got to the airport, I said, this place is heaven. This is a biblical heaven I've read so much about, and down there is, you know what it means, is hell. Because everything seemed perfect. From the humans, that is the people, down to the taxi man, everywhere the road is clean, no deaths around. In fact, I was stunned with the things I saw here. Honestly, everything, the system is well structured, is organized, and it's working. You know, some places the system might be structured but it's not functioning, it's not working, it's also a problem. But everything is working here, everything seems perfect. In fact, the only imperfection I've seen here, which is not the making of the Canadians, is the weather. But it's perfect, it's good for them. You understand? It seems imperfect because I'm coming from a place that is so hot.
Yeah.
You know? But believe me, this is the ideal heaven. Believe me, this place is heaven.
So you think it is heaven on earth?
It's a heaven on earth. Okay.
And the main reason why you are saying that is not because you've been to actual biblical heaven, but the good things of life that you're seeing, and you were stunned by them.
Yes.
And you've only been here for, is it 2 years, 3 years?
No, I've just been here for a few days. This is, today we'll make it the 12th day.
So less than 2 weeks.
Yes.
Less than 2 weeks.
And I'm impressed with everything.
Don't you think it's too early to come to such conclusions? 12 days. Somebody might be thinking, I told you to say this thing, so are you sure? Are you sure in the 12 days you've been?
In Igbo language, they say, from the smell of fat, that's how you know when, how shit will taste. You understand? Mm-hmm. And again, when you look at the corn, just they're merely looking at it, you know that this corn is mature or is not.
It's not mature, yeah.
So, I don't need to see every part of Canada. I've just seen Lekki. From the transport system, is it the healthcare system? Over there, you have access to buy antibiotics and all that, but it's not like that here.
Tell us about it. Okay, wait. Tell us about that. Okay, over there. Yeah. When it's over there, you mean? Ghana.
Nigeria.
Now you mean Nigeria?
Okay. I mean Africa.
Okay.
But here, like when I got this cold, so I went to the pharmacy to buy antibiotics. No, it's not possible.
They say it's not possible.
Yes, okay. What they can give me is OTC drug, over-the-counter drug.
Mm-hmm.
They gave me Tylenol.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I also called a friend. I said, bro, what's happening? I'm dying. I'm having fever. I'm cold. My temperature is too high. I'm coughing. He said, he laughed. He said, man, this place is not in Nigeria. You just go and tell them to give it Tylenol, the same drug. So I went to the pharmacy. The guy gave me Tylenol and gave me Hacks.
Mm-hmm.
And that was all. So I started taking it. I asked him, how many times can I take this drug? He said, I can take it about 6 times. I said, no, I cannot do this. I'll do morning and night because of my liver. He said, no, that your liver is not going to get damaged. That I have to take enough water. I said, no, but in Nigeria, it's usually morning and night. You don't even care if it's 6 hours or 8 hours, you know. So everything is perfect because this is a system that understands that too much intake of this drug or antibiotic affects the system. So I think that's why there is a restriction. Nigeria, you can buy anything.
You can buy anything anywhere. Pharmacy.
You need not to wait for doctor's prescription, but here you will need a doctor's prescription to have access to.
Okay, so that last sentence there is the most powerful thing he's saying for you guys to catch. You see, in Ghana, you could literally walk to any drugstore and buy any medication. That is not the same thing in Canada. In Canada, there are some basic medications you can buy off the counter without a doctor's prescription. Some of them you can never buy them. You must actually see a doctor who actually prescribed that. And they have a system of verifying that it's coming from a licensed medical doctor before you can get that medication. So even though he went to the pharmacist hoping to get what he wants, it will never be given to him until the doctor actually prescribes it. Even if he has the money, they will sell it to him. If the pharmacist sells it to him, that pharmacy will lose his license because he sells something that has not been prescribed by a medical doctor. Why? Life is very important here. You want to make sure what is going into people have been approved by experts. But you see what we have back home. This is the comparison that when I do, somebody will say, I'm putting down Africa. Does it make sense to you that you go and sit in a public transport? Somebody comes to stand there and begins selling medication, herbal medication. Let's assume that it is working great. But what if it is not working and it's going to damage our body?
God.
Who is there to oversee that? Who is there to make sure that what we are consuming is actually good for us? Anybody can sell anything and people just consume it. At the end of the day, we just kill ourselves like that. So that is why it is so regulated that you can't just buy any medication. It has to come with it. In fact, even if you had a medical doctor's prescription, it's not like you just go and give it to you. So you would have gone and given it to them. They will check your ID.
Yes.
They will check where you live.
Yeah, they check.
And then on top of that, they actually will tell you to wait for about 30 minutes where they actually have to run background
check
to see that this is actually coming from. And then when you look at it, you say, wow, you see why people are not dying from stupid medications, right? But there is a quack medical drugstore right now, many of them all over our country. And you see what is happening. People will go in and buy just anything, and then it's the implications. Some of them, they don't have the proper medical ingredients, or, you know, some of them are low quality. Some of them from India. Some of them, we are not even supposed to be taking them. And then you know what happens after that, right? Exactly. Our systems get damaged like that. So guys, that is a safety reason why medically you cannot just go to it. Try it. When you come here, try it. Just go there and just say you want anything and see what they do sell it to you. You need to have a piece of ID. And you need to actually be coming with a prescription to get certain medications, as he talked about. So that alone, you know, that alone is what he's proud of. That the fact that he cannot just go and pick anything he wants. He likes that. Even though he didn't get what he wanted, he said he respects that system. It means human life is important to them, you know.
Yeah.
Anyway, so welcome once again. Let me go to my man. You've been here for 5 days now?
Yes.
You've been here for five days?
I came in on Monday.
Okay. Okay, which airline did you use?
Canada Airline.
Okay, when you're coming straight, you use Canada.
Yeah.
Okay, and then you.
Yeah, Canada. I use the Air France.
Air France.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. From Lagos to Paris. From Paris, Air Canada to.
From Paris, Air Canada to Toronto.
Yes.
Okay. Welcome. And when you were coming, you were in touch with me, and we discussed a few things.
Yes.
So you use Quebec or Montreal.
Montreal.
How was the arrival there when you came through Quebec? You could have come through Toronto. But you went through Quebec. When you went through the Montreal airport, how was it?
Everything was okay. When I went there, when I got to Montreal, there was a machine there. So you have to put your passport, enter your information, they ask you many things, how long do you want to stay. So after that, after the machine, he came out with a small receipt or something like that. So then after that time, I meet the immigration. He asked me, how long do you want to stay? Where are you going? And I told him all the information. Then he asked me one particular question.
Mm-hmm.
You said you are going to Niagara Falls. I said, yes.
Mm-hmm.
From Toronto to Niagara Falls, how do you get there?
How do you get there?
I didn't know that the distance is small, far like this. So mm-hmm. I just said, what? Well, I'm going to rent a car that I'll be using throughout my stay in Canada.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay. So he asked me, what do I do for a living? I told her, you are welcome.
Okay.
Give me my passport back.
Okay, so pay attention to that question there. The immigration officer at the airport asked. So your final destination is Toronto.
Yes.
Okay.
But you are landing in Montreal. How are you getting to?
Yes. There was another question. He asked me that you're supposed to, where you want to stay is Toronto, but you came in through Montreal. Why? I said, well, when I was looking for tickets, I saw that tickets to Montreal is more cheaper, like $500 difference to Toronto. That was why I came through there.
That one, your mind started thinking of this answer real quick. That was a good one there. So I think, guys, let me use this opportunity to elaborate on these two questions that the officer asked. If you decide to, hey guys, it's not everybody that should be going through Montreal.
Yes,
there are some people who choose to go to Montreal. There are reasons why people choose to go to Montreal instead of Toronto. For example, somebody could use a student visa, be coming through Toronto, for example. Our airport there is called Pearson Airport. Mm-hmm. And, you know, sometimes the officers there can be a little bit of a pain in terms of the questions they may ask you and all of that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, especially if you are coming a little bit late into your program. Maybe your program started in September, but you didn't get your visa early. You got your visa 1.5 months or 2 months after, and you still decided to come. There have been people who had some... No, I don't want to generalize, guys. I don't want to say it's 100% everybody. There have been some people who had some really not too cool experiences at the Toronto airport, where they arrived a month and a half after the school had started. And the officers kind of just frustrated them and said, you know what, we are not sure you are going to really go to the school because school has already started. You may have to go back to Nigeria, you may have to go back to Ghana and come back again if you show us proof that you have actually registered for the program. You know, if you've been following me for about a year now, you know I have interviewed people who went through some of these experiences. So it is actually some of these that has actually made us figure out which airports are more friendly to travelers and which airports are a little bit more friendly, not friendly to some travelers. Think about it. You are going to the US with a B1, B2, which is a visitor's visa, right? There are certain airports. When you arrive at those airports in the US, it feels as if you are doing a brand new visa
interview. Sure.
Right? Yes, you go through Michigan, Detroit. Sometimes, just by landing there alone, it feels as if you are going through a brand new interview all over again.
Sure.
But there are also some airports that when you get there, the process is smoother. One, it is from human to human. Two, it is also from standards of airport to airport. So depending on your situation, this is not to say anybody coming here should go through a certain airport. But if you know your situation is already off the mark a little bit, you know what I mean? For example, your program or your conference should have been last week.
Yeah.
Conference started last week, but you didn't get your visa early. You are coming 1 week after the conference. Technically, your situation is off. A serious immigration official at the border could actually use that to say you are coming too late. I'm not sure you are actually going for the conference and may refuse you entry into the country. So if you know your situation so well and you know that you could have trouble, you could carefully pick your airport when you are buying your ticket. So there are some people when they talk to me and I chat with them, I'm like, hey, given your situation, you are likely to run into this trouble if you go through this airport. So maybe because of that, consider going through this other airport. Now, so far, people have said that going through the Montreal airport, especially if you have an off-case scenario, is so smooth. They don't stress you. Those guys there in Montreal, I don't know. You know, Montreal is like little France. Quebec is in Quebec. It is like little France in Canada. They are French. Their things are just so different. And so far, almost anybody I know who went through Montreal, whether with a visitor's visa, whether with a conference, whether with schooling, they came a bit late. It's been so smooth. They don't stress them. Lord V went through Montreal. He was going to New Brunswick. He went through stress-free process. But sometimes, you know, hey, I'm not trying to put down my guys in Toronto Airport. But the truth is, sometimes they'll question you and make you feel like, you know what I mean? So, hey, you know what I mean? Some of the questions that you were asked right now, if these same questions were asked in Toronto, it would have led to maybe one thing to the other. And then you think you have arrived, but then they could decide to say, you know what, I'm not satisfied that your intentions for coming are good. And, you know, so you went there and it was easy, man. The two questions they asked him. So you are going to Toronto.
Yes.
The officer is thinking that he could have easily bought a ticket that would land in Toronto since there's an airport there.
Yes.
How come you're coming through Montreal first?
Mm-hmm.
So he had to now quickly say that when I was looking for ticket online, this was the cheapest one I got. And I was trying to protect my dollar, so I bought this one. See that one? The second question he asked is that, how are you getting here from Montreal to Toronto? How are you getting there? Because you can drive 7 hours or so to drive from Montreal to Toronto.
No. Mm-hmm. She said from Toronto because she asked me where do I want to visit. I told him, I told her how many places then. So she picked that particular Niagara Falls.
You said you
didn't know the distance. Yeah, I didn't know the
Niagara
distance
Falls in my area
from
where I live.
Niagara Falls to Toronto.
You didn't know the distance, so okay.
She was just asking me, how do you get to this Niagara Falls from Toronto?
And
I said, okay, I will get a cab.
Which is actually a good answer. Yes. Because, I mean, think about it. You just came from Toronto to my place. You came with a car. Yes.
It's very far, yeah.
Because you don't have a car at the moment, so you can.
When I just told her I will rent a cab to her. Oh, okay.
Yeah. Beautiful. Anyway, just to chip this one in, if you decide to use the Montreal airport, I recommend that you have a connecting flight.
Yes.
Unless your school or your purpose of coming is Montreal. But if it's in another province or another city, you want to make sure you have a connecting flight if there is an airport heading there.
I sure I do that too.
You show that, that yes, you have a connecting flight from Montreal to Toronto. So that it doesn't look like you just came here and you are using bus to, you know what I mean? Be smart with that. And those of you who have been following me, you know yesterday I played an audio in one of my videos. Let me see if I can actually play that audio for those who didn't catch it, where a lady who got her visa late, almost 2 months after school had started, and was so worried whether she should come or she shouldn't come and stuff. Let me see if I can play it here. Okay, so...
Please, thank you so much. Everything was a success.
Give me 1 second.
I'm here in Montreal. I'm at my uncle's place. Thank you so much. Everything was successful yesterday. No question, as she said. So I'm just here. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. I'm most grateful. God bless you and your family. Bye-bye.
I want you to count the number of thank yous the lady said. Count the number of thank yous.
So I'm just here. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. I'm most grateful. God bless you and your family. Bye bye.
All right. That is it there. I hope you guys. Okay, let me lower. Okay. So that is it there. Anyway, guys, welcome. And
thank you, sir.
As somebody who has lived here for a little over almost, this is my 9th year now.
Wow.
Canada is not perfect. I think the things we are seeing here is surprising to us just because of the contrast, you know. We are comparing it to back home, and so we see it's like a big deal. Yeah. For those of us who live here or people who have been living in Canada for a long time, they think this is actually mediocre. Canadians are actually not happy with how things are. In fact, if you follow our politics, the Canadians bash the government a lot. The Liberal government is under a lot of fire. People are complaining about so many things that this could improve. So to the Canadian, Canada could get better or could be more. But to somebody who is here for the first time as a visitor or a new person in Canada, this looks like heaven on earth. You
sure,
see that?
Sure,
so
sure.
I think it has to do with where we are all coming from and how we see it.
Background.
You understand?
No.
Yeah. Definitely, if we compare it to most of our countries in Africa, Canada is way ahead. Way ahead in different areas.
Sure.
So I hope that as you explore Canada more, you begin to see the different sides of Canada, and then you enjoy Canada as well. Enjoy the cold too. I know you don't like the cold already. The cold has gotten you already. You don't like the cold.
No worries, you'll be okay.
All right. Okay. So, You guys are both, you came with a conference. Is this your first time applying for something like this?
This is my first time applying for a conference, and
and you got it on the first shot?
Yes.
Okay, all right. And
for conference.
So now
I've once applied as a student. That's way back in 2017.
You applied as a student. You were not successful?
Yes.
Okay. And this time you applied for a conference, to attend a conference, they gave you that one?
Yes.
Isn't it surprising that when you wanted to come to school, they say no. But you want to come for conference, they say yes. All right. So welcome, and I hope the conference was good.
It was wonderful.
Wonderful.
Yes.
Good, beautiful. You connected with different people.
Yeah, we had the opportunity to meet some business moguls who are
Canadian business. Okay.
Canadian business men.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I learned a lot from that conference, and it has helped reshape my thinking.
Okay. So when you go back home, you are taking a lot back home to improve things in Nigeria, right?
Yes.
Okay. What were you doing in Nigeria? Did you have your own business? Were you working for somebody? Are you just a graduate from school? Obviously, you're married. He's married, by the way.
Yeah. I have a factory, just a cottage factory, where we buy palm nuts we crush, extract the oil, then supply to those who refine, deodorize the gum, and it becomes vegetable oil.
Mm.
Yeah, but some for some time the business has been shaky. Mm. I'm also a chef. I cook. In fact, I'll be launching my place, my restaurant next month in Nigeria. It's I create recipes.
You so create recipes,
why,
okay.
Yes, I invent recipes. That's why it would be difficult for anybody to man that place if I'm not on.
If you are not,
I need to teach
them how to.
I need to teach the workers how to do this, create these recipes. Because one thing about food is, if there's no consistency in taste, you lose your customers.
That's true.
Yeah.
That's from a chef. Or if there is no consistency in taste,
yes,
you lose your customers.
Because customers want to have that taste whenever they buy your product. They want to have that
same taste that made them come back.
That's the only thing that will bring them back to your restaurant. But if they come today, it's tasting curry, it's too sweet, it's salty, they'll run away.
Mm.
They'll begin to seek for alternative place. And then you must ensure that they are getting value and the product is affordable.
Wow. So quality, satisfaction, and then affordability at the same time.
Yes.
You need to give it to the customer. Yes. And you know, I used to wonder, like, how come you can go to McDonald's or KFC and the taste is the same? And that's exactly what you said, consistency.
I think they have a pattern, they have a model.
Mm-hmm.
The KFC, the McDonald's, they have a model.
Mm-hmm.
Food, if you want, and the secret, I don't know, maybe I have to say it, if you want to pattern that model, you must have a measurement. You say a pinch of salt for this, for maybe 2 kg or 2 grams of flour, whatever. If you exceed that pinch of salt, it will taste different. The taste will never be the same again.
That's true.
So it's part of the modeling. You must ensure that
everything is scripted,
yes,
on point, yeah, measured.
But there is something about those, and I don't want to criticize, there's something about those kind of food over years. This is the reason why people say sometimes in the food industry there is no creativity. When you pattern a model, it tends to stay over time.
Before, like, it's difficult to change it.
It's difficult to infuse
new
recipes. Yeah. Trying to, but because you come, this bread is bland.
It has to be made like this.
Why, in the culinary, I see cooking as art, and
it's an art.
Baking is science. Baking, you must follow particular rules or principles. You must preheat the oven before you put your
preheat, that's true,
and everything.
It is here that I learned that too. Back home, we just put it straight to the oven or fires. Yeah.
If you don't do those things, it will flop. You'll fail. But in cooking, you can actually start by adding your oil, then maybe toasting or salting your meat or your onion. You can start from the middle and finish well, or even from the end and still finish. But in baking, you must
preheat.
You must follow the rules.
You can't.
Yes.
I like what you said about it being an art and science. When I was in GSS, my vocational skills teacher, Mrs. Edith Tamaklo, I remember you taught us this first time teaching us vocational skills. She said, catering is the art and science of cooking and serving food.
Okay.
So it's both an art and it's a science of cooking and serving food. Thank you so much. You know, now we have a chef in the house there. So yesterday when you came and then we were having dinner together, I'm pretty sure you were checking all the things in the corners of the taste and everything.
This year was the first time I had a taste of Banku. And I've heard too much about this Banku. Even some musicians use it to sing.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure that Banku is cultural to the Ghanaian.
It's cultural. It's a cultural
meal. So I was happy when you said you need to have a taste Banku.
Yes.
I
must taste this.
And believe me, I finished
everything. You finished everything, that's true.
Drank the soup.
You drank the soup.
It was wonderful. I don't know how to express my feelings.
That's from the chef, by the way. So the credit goes to my wife, right?
Yeah.
All right, thank you so much. So he's a chef by profession. Yeah. He runs his own business. He has a factory where he does some stuff around the palm oil business, you know, extracting the skin or the oil from the kernel, and then the process, and then also sold to industries. And he talked about the fact that he's been shaky for a while, but there is a businessman. And then he also has as a chef, he has a brand new restaurant that he's actually planning to roll out, like a chain of restaurants. He's invested so much. Yesterday we're talking, the investment is massive into that. I pray that your business succeeds, and I pray that with all the ideas you got, attending this conference, meeting Canadian investors, some business people there, some of this can also impact in your business positively when you return back home. All right. You came here for a different reason. You didn't come here for conference. No. You came to explore and see Canada.
Yes.
You could have gone to Ghana to go and see Ghana. You didn't come. No, I'm not happy. You have to be Pan-African. You need to promote Africa. You decided to enter plane to come and explore Canada and see Canada. Come and do sightseeing. This man could have come to Ghana to come and see Independence Square or to come and see Choco. He didn't come. He doesn't even need a visa to come for that one. He chose to come and see. In the cold weather, the man said he wants to come and see Niagara Falls.
It's just coming down here than going any other place in Africa, especially Nigeria or Ghana, because I don't know much about Ghana, but I know much about Nigeria because of the security issue. So it's not okay for
me to travel from
around. Even where I was living in Akure, I don't want to travel to any part of Nigeria because of the security
issues. So, yeah, if you know Nigeria, you know this is big, huh? It's difficult to safely say you can move from one part of Nigeria to the other without being worried in your mind that something may happen, right? If you make it luckily, you start saying it's the grace of God. If you make it from one place to the other,
when you travel.
And if you are going, you know it's possible you can be kidnapped. Anything it's possible, road, you know, so. Any wonderful thing can happen on the road there. It's beautiful. Nice. So that's what he meant there, that it's more difficult traveling within Nigeria than outside. So he prefers to just go. So he's here as a tourist to come and see Canada. If there is any bad side of Canada, this is the man who is supposed to tell you. By the time he's going back, I'll interview him again so that he can tell you what he came to see in Canada. I'll tell you again. Yes. You're also married?
Yes.
How many kids?
Two.
Are you guys in your 30s, 40s?
Yes, we're in our 30s.
Okay. How many kids do you have?
I have one and another is coming.
Yes. Oh, you are very effective. You've been working. Mr. Chef has been cooking and cooking everywhere. He has one beautiful on the way. Right? Congratulations to you in advance. Wish you a very successful delivery on your new baby coming. Okay. All right. Level of education, or let's talk about growing up. How was it like for you growing up?
My brother, it's not easy. It's not easy because, well, I could say that since 2002-2003, I've been living my life all by myself, nobody except God. So all my journey for the past almost 20 years now is just by the grace of God. So nothing is working. But I thank God for the grace and the privilege to be here today. So I have my mother, my father died 1988, sorry. So, and I'm the last one of our family. My mother gave birth to 7 children. So, but I thank God. The journey is not easy, but with the prayer, and the only, one of the things that I really appreciate my parents, I always thank God for them, is that they let me know the way of God.
Okay.
And that really gave me opportunity to be where I am today. So it's just by the grace of God.
Amen. Yes. Amen. And you are a tough seed.
My brother.
Because some of the things that you were sharing with me, I think that is actually what made us. Guys, I didn't plan to do this video with them this morning, to be honest. I didn't plan. I just wanted to vibe with them, connect with them, see what we can do together. And when he came and he began sharing some aspect of his story, I said, man, I think people need to hear this.
Yes.
You've been applying for visa. Is this your first time applying for a visa?
No, it's not my first time. I applied for Canada. First time I applied for Canada visa was 2010. So that time I didn't know much about the documentation. So they asked for the bank statement. I don't have bank. There's not even money to get there. I don't even have up to 10,000 naira in my bank account that time.
Wow.
Yes.
And you were applying for visa?
Yes, I applied for visa. There's something they call Oluwole.
What does it mean?
Oluwole.
Fake document where you can perfect.
Okay, I got you. Yeah, okay. So, mm-hmm.
That time, I said, okay, let me try. I tried, they denied me, 2010. I said, no problem. So I still keep struggling, hustling. Then 2012, I tried again to apply for the visa for another. I got invitation from one conference. I applied for a particular conference that time, 2012. So they denied me again.
That's the third time?
Second time. So after that time, I applied for Japan visa. They gave me, but I don't have money to travel. I don't even have money to go to Lagos State from Akure because I don't have
from Akure to Lagos State. You didn't even have money.
No money because the Japan visa was very, very cheap. I think we pay around 1,000 naira that time. So it's just like free visa.
Free visa, okay.
So after that time, I said, okay, let me try America. 2013. Yeah, 2013 February, I tried American visa. They denied me based on my own fault because I lied about. There's something they call control. You can control your visa as if you have traveled to social country. So I did that and the thing backfired at that time. So I said, wow, I know it was my mistake. So I didn't do anything. So I still keep on moving that. Okay, I will still try my best. After 6 months, I applied for America again in Lagos. They denied me. I said, okay, let me try again. After like some month again, I applied to U.S. Embassy again.
Third time.
Three times, U.S. Embassy, two times, Canadian Embassy. So that time I said, okay, I need to do something. I need to find alternative. Okay. Let me just leave these two countries for that. But my mind was Canada or U.S. that time. So when I got the Japanese visa, I didn't even worry about the visa. Okay, let me just try alternative. So that time, I tried Korean visa. They gave me the visa. But I don't want to go to Korea because I don't like Korea for anything. So I said, okay, let me still try another country. After that time, I tried Mexico visa. They gave me Mexico visa. So I wanted to go to Mexico based on some information I got from my friend. Okay, you can go to Mexico from there. You can cross
here.
Okay.
I'll talk about Mexico. I'll do a video where I talk about how people also go to Mexico and do wonderful things there. We'll talk about that.
Let me apply. They gave me the visa.
This visa that you applied, which one did they just give you? Was it Korea or Mexico? Which one?
They gave me Korea. After the Korea, okay. I applied for Mexico. They gave me because I don't want to go to
Korea.
So I want to go to US. So I applied to the Mexico embassy. They gave me the visa. So when they gave me, before that time, I applied to Schengen visa from Poland embassy. They denied us. Me with some guys, they denied all of us. So I said, okay, after that time, I went to Mexico, they gave me the Mexico visa. Okay, I wanted to travel to Mexico. Then from Mexico,
Do a crossover, like 31st night.
like 31st night. So, but because I don't have money, so it was difficult for me even to buy the ticket because the ticket was very expensive from Nigeria to Mexico. So I said, okay, what will I do? Okay, let me find an alternative. So that time, I normally go to system, check, I sit down, I work on system many times. I can sit down on a system from morning to night, just be looking for some information that will give me opportunity. So that time, I was just looking for some information. Then I got another information concerning conference in Japan. So that time, I said, okay, let me apply again. So I applied for it. Japanese visa again, then I got the visa.
So you went to Japan with conference?
Yes.
Did you guys hear that? So you can also use conference to even go to Japan or Korea. Okay. That was 2015.
Yes. So I think, okay, let me just go to Japan then, spend 2 weeks. I will come back to Nigeria then going to Mexico. But when I got to Japan, I saw that, oh my, no. Here, okay, I'm here now. I don't have money to buy tickets, even if I go back to Nigeria to go to Mexico. Then let me just stay here, then move on with my life.
The traveler has arrived. He said, let me just stay here for a while.
Yeah, so that was how the journey started from Japan. So I was there for many years. So around 2017, after I went to Japan 2015, 2017, I applied for one school here in Canada.
Mm-hmm.
So they gave me
college or university?
College, like polytechnic. Mm-hmm. So they gave me 2 years
program. Mm-hmm.
So that I was okay, let me try my best again. So I arranged all the documents, everything, because in Japan you need to translate all your documents from Japanese language to English. So I got everything, then I applied. So I applied January 2018. I got the admission 2017. So when I applied April 2018, I got their message from their website that they denied the visa, it was not approved. I said, okay, why? When I go through the reason, I didn't understand. They just
generic.
Wrote many things.
Many things, okay, generic.
I need to find out what happened. Then that time, I used
GCM,
so just to know why they denied me. So when I used that, I pay for it. Then they told me that it was because I don't have enough fund.
Proof of funds.
Proof of funds. Okay. And secondly, because of my status in Japan.
Yeah, your status in Japan. So those of you in Asia, you watch it. They sometimes will check the country that you are living in, if it's not your original country of birth, to figure out what your immigration status in that country is.
Yes.
So there are some immigration status that can make your transition to another country easy. There are some that are shaky.
Yeah.
For example, you are there visiting, and from there you are trying to connect to another country. You know.
So that time, I know many of my guys told me that, don't waste your money, it will not work because of your status. I said, okay, I don't care. I like to take risks. If it work out, fine. If it don't work out,
you just work. Like to try.
Yeah, so I know that when I read the reason why they denied the application, I said, okay, these people were right, so no problem, I will just keep trying. So 2019, that time, I have the normal resident visa at that time.
So, In Japan.
In Japan. Okay. So 2019, I applied to America. They denied me.
I'm trying to keep track of the denial. I've lost track of it.
So that was fourth time
for US.
For US.
Four. 1, 2, 3, 4. Yes. I hope you guys are listening. Yes.
Fourth time, 2019. Okay. I applied to UK. UK. After US denied me, so okay, I know what to do. I will not need to waste my money. Let me apply to Europe. I know Europe will give me because of my status at that time. So I applied to France. France gave me visa.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay, what I need to do is that I wanted to go to Europe, have many traveling experience on my passport.
On your passport.
So before going back to US. When I applied to France gave me the visa. I went to France. You know, you can easily move between the Europe
Schengen visa.
So I said, okay, I need 5 stamps on my passport before
you plan all that.
Yes, I planned everything stamps. Already.
Okay.
So when I
let's count the countries you went. Russia.
So, no.
That one, I just sneak that one in for us to laugh.
So when I went to when I got to France, they asked me how long do you want to stay. I told them 2 days. Oh, what? 2 days? You have 3 months visa. Yes, I just want to stay here 2 days, I'm going to another country. I said, okay. So I stay 2 days in Paris. From there, I moved to Switzerland.
Mm-hmm.
From Switzerland to Turkey. From Turkey back to Belgium.
Mm.
From Belgium to Germany.
Hey.
So
the man from Mandongo, where they move like that too.
So I got all these stamps on my passport.
You achieve your 5-stamp target.
My 5-stamp. So when I came back to Japan, I applied to UK. UK denied me. Despite
with all the five stamps?
Yes.
UK.
So, UK denied me because based on the information, because American, Canada, UK, Australia, New Zealand, they share data. So easily
Abeg,
they can.
Listen, don't be me where I talk, I'm listening. Yeah. Abeg, say it again.
America, US, New Zealand, Australia, UK, all these five countries share data. So they can
share easily, database on immigration.
Yes, okay. They can easily access your information.
Mm.
So they asked me why my previous visa was denied. So I explained to them, but I know they still, they can access the information. So they denied me the visa. They just gave me unreasonable reason why they, I said, okay, I don't really bother with their decision. So after the UK denied me, December 2019, I applied to US, then US denied me. When they denied me, I applied to Canada again. Canada denied me again.
It's all right, let's stop the denial from there. If I don't take time today, I'll deny it, we'll just go to talk.
So totally, when they denied me, I said, okay, no problem, I'll still try. But after the 2019, yeah, so I just pipe load and need to work on my status. So 2020 January, I traveled to Singapore. So because they asked me some question during the American interview section, so the lady was asking me some question that I know, okay, you want some information, but I don't want to disclose that question.
Okay, yeah.
So January 2020, then I went to Singapore. I stayed just one day. I came back to Japan. So this last year, 2021, I don't have money. I don't have anything. Okay, let me try this America again. Maybe you don't know it. Nigerian guys, you know, there's a way you can just quickly run.
Run things, yeah.
You understand?
Running it, money, yeah.
Yes, within 1 month. So I just did that. Then I booked my interview. I just went there. The guys were just, yeah. But one thing I want people to understand that all the information I've been using since 2010, everything was the same.
Key, very important.
You don't want to just alter your information. They want to know that you are desperate. You're just
all my information.
You're consistent with your information.
The only thing that maybe is not the same is the address and the location.
And then maybe the amount in your bank
amount,
statement.
Yes. So when I went to American interview last year, December, they asked me, where are you going? What do you want to do? I'm just going for Christmas. He asked me many questions. I answered. At the end of the day, so your visa is approved. I said, wow. Thank God. At the end of the day, I got the visa last year. So I went to US. I stayed like maybe 1 week, then came back to Japan. Yes.
After wanting to try Mexico, yeah, and you finally went there. Now 1 week when you stay.
Yes. So yeah. I stay 1 week because normally my mind was, I don't, for me personally, I don't want to live in the US.
Why?
Because of the US security, every day shooting. So I don't.
So because of security reasons and the issues in the US, that's why you don't like.
I don't want to stay there. So I prefer Canada.
You prefer Canada.
So then when I was watching your program, because I monitor the this you can change from working or those kind of stuff to so my mind, I thought it was going to close this year, February. So generally that time I was just watching your video, then I saw that you said Canadian government had decided to extend. So, when I saw it, I said, wow, this is an opportunity for me to try this this thing again. Then around March, April, March, I decided to arrange all the documents. May, first week of May, I applied for the Canadian visa again. Less than 3 weeks, the visa came.
Less than 3 weeks, they approved it.
Because you share the information about the new portal.
Yes.
So immediately you share. Before that time, I was using the old portal, trying to download the application form.
The forms and fill it.
So immediately you just gave the information about the new portal. I just, wow, thank God. This will save me time and some, even of attaching, do this.
I remember you so well. You know, he's also on my subscribers page. You know, for those of you who know, I have a private group where people subscribe to join. If you look on the screen there, It will probably be showing on your screen as subscribed to Joint Chuck Millionaire. So he is there. He's a subscriber. And I remember him asking questions right from the beginning. He asked questions a lot.
Yeah, so
he asked questions a lot. Trust me.
That time I just applied. Less than 3 weeks. Mm-hmm. Less than 3 weeks. I just got their message. Okay, bring your passport.
Your passport.
We are going to issue you. So that was how I got the visa there.
Congratulations, finally.
Thank you.
How many years did they give you for your visitor's visa to come to Canada?
They gave me till when my passport will expire, because my passport will expire very soon, August. So they gave
August next year?
Yes.
So you gave you close to 1 year?
1 year. Okay. More than one year.
A little over 1 year?
Yes.
Okay, because your passport was expiring.
Yes.
So sometimes the expiry date in your passport is key, yeah?
Yes.
There are people who get 10 years because they have 10 years passport.
Yeah, yeah.
There are people who get 9 years because they have 9 years passport. So if you have 1 year passport, like
they
your passport
they
is expiring, they cannot issue
more than expiring date.
That is that sometimes you want to make sure you have a couple more years in your passport when applying. You know what I mean? Yeah.
Yes.
Congratulations.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
People have been counting the number of deniers. When we finish the interview, I'm pretty sure you're gonna read it. They are keeping track of whatever. Me, I lost track, but my followers, some of them are keeping track of it.
Yes, I
saw it. So you now understand why I said he's a tough seed. In fact, the other gentleman who is a chef is also a serious tough seed. If you hear his own story, too, it's mind blowing. But the thing about these two guys is that even though this is a Yoruba and this is an Igbo man, they have the same destiny and desire that they just want to succeed. One is an entrepreneur cracking code, trying to succeed. The other one is also just, you know, this man's story, isn't it? Look, from Mandungo, which is where he's Mandungo, right? In Akure, right? In Ondo State, he could not even get transportation to move from there to Lagos. So when he got his Japanese visa, it was even hard for him to even buy a ticket to come. Some people's story is real, though. Some people get visa right now, as I'm talking to you, they don't have money to buy, you know. Anyway, let me use this opportunity to give a special shout out to this gentleman, Mr. Barrister. I forgot your last name. Barrister. I forgot your last name. You decided to donate money to help one of my followers who has gotten a visa but is struggling to raise money to buy his ticket. To be honest, when I shared that story, I wasn't sharing it because I wanted people to help. I was sharing it because I want you to see how it can be hard for some people to the point where their families cannot even raise money for them to buy a ticket. And for some reason, something touched your heart. Mr. Barrister, I forgot your last name. You said you want to give 1,000 Ghana cedis to this man.
Wow.
I have taken down your email. I'm going to put the two of you in touch. And God richly bless you for sowing a seed into this man's life. I remember my own self, when I got my visa, I actually had to be calling people to ask for money to buy my ticket because I didn't have it. And God brought some wonderful people into my life. Mrs. Eugene, Mrs. Emana, and then Mr. Eugene Na, the evangelist Eugene Na. You live in Ghana, and God touched the heart of your son in the U.S. I hadn't even talked to your son before. He just sent $500. Said, toss your, you know. And it melts me. Somebody who hasn't even talked to me before, right? I will never forget that. And when you get to those moments, sometimes you just question yourself, was I born into the wrong family? Because you can't even get any support from any member of your family. Extended family. Nobody is, in fact, no help. That is how serious it can be. You have to actually go to friends. You have to go to people. Sometimes some people have to actually go and promise and do all kind of things just to buy a ticket. It's real. You will understand it if you have been through it. It may not mean anything to you if you have never been through it. So, Mr. Barrister, God richly bless you.
Amen.
I'm hoping to actually connect the two of you. We'll probably do a video call on Zoom so that you can see the gentleman and probably possible meet him in Ghana and then, if possible, see him off at the airport as well. God bless you there. All right.
There's one thing I want to
say. You want to say that? Okay.
You just need to do it yourself. You have to pray then also yourself. I discovered some things when I came to Japan. I discovered that in Africa, we always pray. We don't take the
action.
We don't take action. We sit down, we go to church every day, but you don't take action. We need to take action. You pray, you take action. You pray, you take action. Not that, okay, every day you just sit down. I because when I left Nigeria to Japan, nobody knew I was not in Nigeria. Even none of my family know that. Okay, where this boy is, they know. Then they call me. We talk on WhatsApp call. They call me. How are you? Oh, I'm fine. It was after 6 months. I told my mother, I'm not in Nigeria. Where are you? Ma, God don't do that. So it's not easy. Just,
you know, that's what I also did. When I was leaving, members of my family didn't know.
No, nobody knew, because when I first got my first visa, no, I searched for money everywhere. Nobody could even give me just 1,000 naira like this.
That's serious.
Yes. Because everybody was just complaining, you know, there's no money, you know, there's no money, you know, there's no money.
But if not die, where you die right now, they go raise money, bury
him.
If he had died, they would have found money to bury him. That's how bad
after
it is.
After that time, I decided, okay, my next step, I need to start getting money from anywhere. I don't steal, I don't do bad things, but I need to do legit something to get visa, to get money to buy my next ticket, because I know that I'm going to this Japan so time next year. So okay. I started
planning and you were taking that. You were not just praying.
No.
I hope you guys got it though. Two things he said: empower yourself to learn to do things. Look, the systems back home, our cultural practice and whichever, maybe not culture, we are just naturally conservative. People like to sit down for others. That is why agents dupe people all the time. In fact, he will tell you about somebody who got duped about $5,000-$6,000, just because of this same information. And he himself will tell you that when he began researching, he became better and better at researching, right? It was the research. Look at it. If you never came across my video where I said, you can now do this and do this and do this, and say, okay, let me take action. Look, he took action.
Yes.
He joined my subscribers page. Use the new portal. You were going to use the old portal.
Yeah.
Saw the new portal. Decided to use that to apply. Within 3 weeks, they approved.
Yes.
But basically, his word here is, guys, DIY should be your slogan.
Yes.
Do it yourself.
Sure.
Learn to do it. Don't say you are not educated. Don't say you didn't go to school. Don't say you don't know too much. Just connect with people who are doing it. You begin to learn. The blessings from those people will touch you. The wisdom from those people will touch you. Just find yourself in a community of people who are taking steps. You take steps. Then he also said something about our spiritual life. You know, he said he's a believer in God. He said, look, he's not the type of person that believes in just faith without action. The Bible says faith without work is dead. It's good to have faith, but you need to take step. You can have faith and say, you know what, I can walk on the water. But the truth is, you got to take that first step and walk on the water.
Sure.
Biggest problem we have. Let me talk about Christianity, because we are Christian. I'm Christian. Is that most Christians just have what we call faith without the work.
Yeah.
Right? We spend all the time and we pray. Awesome. We spend all the time doing the fasting. We spend hours and hours, midweek service and Friday night, we are shooting the devil. We are shooting the devil. Po-po-po-in. You know? Devil, Michichiro, I'm binding you, I'm binding you. We are binding the devil. Go. We've been binding the devil. It's good. Notice, I'm not saying it's bad, though. I have to say it, too, because when we go, we know we bind the devil. We put special chains, chain the devil. We've been binding the devil right from when, since we started church. Remember, Chaka Melonia is not saying it's bad, though. I have prayed and bind the devil, too.
Sure.
But I know I need to rise up when the cock crows. Are you rising up? You see, the Bible says that God has already guaranteed certain things to be a natural part of the blessings for life. When it rains, it doesn't just rain on Muslims. It rains on Christians. It doesn't just rain on Christians. It rains on the Hindu. It doesn't just rain on the Hindu. It even rains on the unbeliever too, who insults God. But when these people rise and work, they'll still get a result for the seed that is sown. That is why an unbeliever can work and still make money. But somebody who prays, can be poor. Why?
Because
the unbeliever is actually sowing seed that will automatically generate according to the natural law of sowing and harvesting and reaping.
Yeah, right.
So here is it, my people. I want you to be very, very, very deep as a Christian, not yes. people who just believe things.
Yes.
The word of God says, I will bless the works of thy hands. Yes. So if God asks you today, what is the work of thy hand? What would you say? Lord, bless me. I came empty-handed, just as I am. What is the work of the hand? And I've given you guys, if you've been watching my video, I've been giving you guys basics of this, a lot of them from the Bible. Some people came to Jesus and said, we are hungry. We need food. Jesus didn't say, stand, I'll command food from, you know. He said, show me what you got. They said, we got two of this and five of this. We got two fishes and five loaves of bread. There's a smart guy. He didn't come empty-handed. You came with something. Now that you came with something, let's turn that something into more. Many of us, we got nothing. Many of us, we take no step. We pray. We pray. We popo. We pray. Some of you have special chains in your bedroom right now. You've been tying that devil spiritually. Wow. After tying, you go and sit down and watch telenovela. How can you watch telenovela and telenovela your life to success? It doesn't work that way. Whereas the unbeliever is on the street hustling.
Hustling
back to back.
Eh? Yeah. And then when we finish, you say Christians are poor. Why can we not be poor? Let me tell you something, guys. Those of you who care about academia, there is a book. There is a philosopher called Max Weber. He studied the history of industrialization and how this world built capital, how money was just, you know, across the Western world, how the Western world was developing. He studied it. And then he studied it and he said, Max Weber said, look, there is something about the Christians of that time. They have this Calvinist spirit. They have this Protestant spirit that tells them that, look, one of the ways that God will know you are my child is that you prosper on this earth. Look at it. One of the signs of knowing that you are a child of God, destined to go to heaven if you die, is to be prosperous on earth. So the Christians of that time, everybody's goal was to succeed and prosper. Materially, everybody was just working hard, hard, hard. So according to Max Weber, it was the spirit of working hard, hard work among the Christians that actually led to the accumulation of wealth in the Western world. So the Christians of those times were the millionaires, billionaires, business owners, because prosperity was a sign of knowing it, that you were a child of. That was how Max Weber thought. He wrote a whole book called The Spirit of. He wrote a whole book, my people. Christians of today, we are some of the laziest.
Sure.
Out of 24 hours, we spend how many hours of this doing spiritual stuff, and we spend less doing physical stuff.
Sure.
How, like, we are living in a physical world, for God's sake. This is matter, M-A-T-T-E-R. Huh? You are occupying space and time, and you are using none of that to occupy the space. Well, you've been living in spiritual realm, and you are a physical being. Spirituality is good by connecting to, you know what I mean? That is where. So you see me like this, I pray, I trust God will bless me, but you see me always grinding and working.
Yeah.
Because I got to show something that God I'm about. The ant is working 24/7. The ant is moving and working. We are not. So that's why the Bible says, go to the ant, thou sluggard, thou fool. Learn from the ways of the ant. The ant is always working. And so I bless the ant. The man said it though. He said, please, him, poor person who could not get transportation, he was not just praying his way. He was taking action. He was taking action. And you see, those who take action, they get results. Only those of you who have been counting the number of times he's been refused the visa, you know. Did he stop sowing the seed?
No.
He sowed the first one, refusal. Did he stop? Sow the second one. Did he stop? No. So the third one, you have been counting how many times. You can even use it to create a football team, the number of times they're refusing. Maybe so. Because the law of averages says, he who keeps sowing will reap bountifully. And he who sows sparingly will reap just like that too. He's been sowing. Are you sowing seed? Are you folding your arms? You have been commanding and reading that scripture. Are you sowing seed or you are just sitting down? What is it that God is going to bless? The laziness of your hand? I hope this one gets you there. I am not one of those creatures who tell you to go and po. Right now you go and watch somebody just, he's still sleeping. You know? The whole night he's been doing po on Facebook. Po in the devil under that. Now, daytime deal. Now, cock, even chicken, fowl is out there working. You are sleeping right now. You see your life? You've prayed all night. Daytime that humans are supposed to be up, you are sleeping. You wake up again, you are going for another one.
Whether
heaven where you won't go fast or so, why don't you just go fast to heaven and go and enjoy it there? Because you're living on planet Earth. You have to pray and you have to work. The Christians of old were the business people that built this world. You see it? If you study the history, you know it. All right. Thank you so much for that encouragement.
Yeah,
doing it yourself, encourage yourself.
Yeah.
And on my platform, you can tell I don't do things for people, though.
Sure.
I will encourage you. Yeah. Was it not a video that I did that showed you how to use the new portal to... Did I do it for you?
No.
Didn't you do it yourself?
No.
Now, don't you know how to do it?
Since the first time I started applying for visa, I did everything myself.
No agent.
No.
Even the one where you go take the transportation, you get.
From 2010. I've never used agent for once. No.
You've never used agent?
I've never used agent.
You talked about an agent. I don't know if you also have an experience with agents who have duped people.
Yeah.
Talked about an agent somebody that got duped for how much? How much does the person do?
$5,000.
For what?
For Canadian working visa.
Working visa so for Canada.
So he said the guy was living. The guy said he met the agent at Dubai. So he told them, okay, I can help you get a working visa. This and so you have to pay so a month. So they pay between $5,000 to $6,000 to the agent. At the end of the day, the agent just gave them one letter, half a letter. Okay, you can go and apply for a visa. So they went there to apply, they denied them. So the money is gone. Wow. Yes.
Well, you know, that job said not be real.
The job is not real. I told the guy, they have scanned him because the job is not real.
The job is
everything
not real.
They can just sit down on the system, design everything.
Design, offer letter. Microsoft software, and then give it to
you. So I was trying to tell the guy that you need LMIA. You
yes. have to check if the company. That job,
yes.
working visa to come to Canada, you need an LMIA.
So I told the guy, did you get that or something like that? I said, no, the guy just told him, okay, after the job offer, you can apply for the visa. They will give you the visa. They will pay for your ticket. Once they just hear that ticket, they will pay for your ticket, give you accommodation. So our people thought, okay, everything is perfect. So they just went ahead. Because already, the agent knew that you are not going to get that visa. And he cannot pay you back.
He knew
everything. Yeah. So, maybe it will tell you, okay, you have to make agreement.
Mm.
They deny you. That's your own problem. But I will get you the job offer. But everything was
and fine. Then he takes his money.
Yes.
You know, somebody contacted me. An agent was also trying to get $10,000 from him for a job. Then I began telling the guy, this is somebody I know. I said, look, ask that agent. One, I would like to know the name of the company so I can research a little bit more about them.
Background check.
Two, I'd like you to show me proof of all the people that you have done this same thing for. Who got it? Show me proof. Don't just show me the visa by picture.
Mm.
Show me the online.
Online.
Go online. Let's log in. I want to see the success. Visa approved. Coming from the Canada immigration. Mm. That one, you get them. Guys, shine your eye.
And sometimes our people...
Don't believe it when they tell you, oh, I have a picture of a visa on there. They can fake it.
They can fake it. Yeah.
Sit with them. Yeah. Let them log in. Go into the system. You want to see Canada now online where they do no paper application now, it's online.
Online everything.
So if
online.
It is genuine, listen to this part. If you use this one alone, you'll get a lot of fake agents. He says, oh, I get visa for people to come to Canada, working visa, $5,000, $10,000, I'll get it for you. Just give me $10,000. And remember, the easiest thing for an agent to do to you is to show you a picture of a visa that I got it for this person. Why? They can easily do that because some people can fake those pictures. Some people can actually fake them. And they know when you see it, your eye will be like, oh my God, Canada. I am telling you, the number one way to crack them is to tell them you want to sit with them. Please, you log in. I want to see all the visa decisions that has come online right there. If the guy is fake, will he log in?
No.
Where is he going to log into? To show you what? Where you can read that decision-making time of submission, time of what? You are seeing, he won't do it though. He won't do it because he doesn't have it.
That was what happened to me when I applied as a student way back in
2017.
The first thing they will do, you have to pay a non-refundable
application. They will take the non-refundable from you, the agents. Yeah. But by the way, guys, those of you who are watching, we are not talking about immigration consultants in Canada.
Yeah,
we are talking about self-styled agents from Africa who are trying to help people. They are the ones who sometimes can mess people up. So that's what he's talking about.
The first thing they will do is they'll actually pay a non-refundable application fee.
Mm-hmm.
And then, without your knowledge, they won't use your email to create the profile.
Why should they use it? So that you will be receiving information straight. They use their own email.
The update they will be giving you is not directly from the portal. They just maybe inform you. You call them and they tell you, oh, just be patient. And at the end of the day, they won't give you the login details. Now, what happened to me? I was denied then in 2017. Then I had already paid whatever what they asked me to pay.
You paid.
I paid school fees. I got admission at British Columbia.
Okay, Vancouver, British Columbia. Okay.
Ascender School of Management.
Mm.
That's where I got the admission. Then, so I pleaded with them when I was denied. I pleaded with them to please give me the login details
so you can see
so that I can be able to assess that my profile and see the reasons why I was denied, and also so that I can be able to get my
GCMS note, which is the visa officer's note, to know the actual reason why
they refused.
The agent refused to give it to you.
I pleaded.
But this is your application.
Yes, I bet. That was
paying for it.
You paid for it.
Yeah, I was crying. I was sending mails. At the end of the day, I went online on Naira Land to, I started making
research.
To get my note. At the end of the day, when I posted on Naira Land that, about my experience with that agent, the agent replied me with their lawyer, one lawyer like that. That I've been, no, I did not say anything about their firm.
Mm-hmm.
I was just questioning why I've been refused access to my profile.
Mm-hmm.
Why? You did not use my email, nothing. If I call and ask you about updates, you just say, okay, wait, you get back to me, then you just call me and tell me this is what is happening. Until they got that rejection or denial from Canadian embassy, that was when they informed me. I waited. In fact, they made me wait for 7 months that year. I was hoping that, in fact, I've succeeded. In fact, I'm leaving for Canada. I waited for 7 months. I could not apply to any other school, any other place.
Wow.
They made me believe that, in fact, you are
you were on your way to Canada.
All
right.
That was a horrible experience.
So at least you can tell that he has he has used an agent before, so he's sharing his experience.
It was a horrible experience. And believe me, I think one problem we have in Africa is our inability to research.
Our inability to research. Okay. Mm-hmm.
You said something, do it yourself.
DIY.
DIY, that is do your research. DYR. Most of our people.
He's giving us another one. DIR.
Yeah.
DYR. Do your research. DIY, do DIY.
We feel that these things are rocket science.
Rocket science. We cannot do it.
It's not possible. Let me look for agent who understands, who is well grounded in this field, and these agents have a way. I've been duped by one agent when I wanted to apply for US too. The man would dress up. He said he's a dog. Way back. Then someday, when I just observed something, and I told my uncle, he said, this thing is a red flag. He will call himself Dr. This. Say, no, I'm going to follow you to this. I'm going. Until...
The guy arranged himself very well.
I'm going to, you know. But this conference happened just like...
Magic.
When it was happening, it was my wife, through my wife.
Oh.
And he just informed my wife that day. My wife shared it. I said, okay, but baby, you know, this Indian people, you know, he said his uncle is not like that. The guy is a solid guy.
Born again.
Yes, so and
born again Christian will be proper. Yes. Maybe those one will go use born again. They fraud you. Say, this one has made me giving up on Jesus.
he was giving information back to back. Like, yeah. You give you number. You are free to call. He called the conference people to confirm
that the conference is legit.
Yeah, he was so open and free.
And he was sharing.
He was sharing information.
Mm.
But all that, whenever in Nigeria, when an agent starts being funny, start hiding information from
then you know it's about to go down.
Yes, it's a red flag. You need to take off. Like that man when I applied to the U.S. embassy. He said he was going to follow me. He gave me questions and answers.
Question and answers. As if you are going to.
He gave me questions and answers on that day. He said, no problem. That he's going to follow me. That he's going for. That we are going to stop at Lesotho. From Lesotho, we'll go to the US.
Lesotho.
Wow. On that day, bro. When I entered that embassy.
Where is Doc? Mr. Doctor, I'm gonna.
He prepared me as a UN agent. Now be listening. See the mistake. See the big lacuna.
Listen, though, guys.
This is why they denied me as a UN staff.
United Nations.
I've never worked in United Nations before. I have not. He just printed, typing. Microsoft and everything, and believe me, US is not ready to see your bank.
Yes,
bank statement.
Yeah, sometimes, sometimes they don't even ask for that.
The woman said, "You claim to be a United Nations staff, and you're single, and you have not traveled to any country before. This is your first time of leaving Nigeria. But you're a UN staff."
That was all.
Just one question.
That was it. He said, no, I'm not convinced. That was it. And he gave me that blue paper.
And when they approve, which one they give?
They will not give you anything. Just give you one paper to go and collect your passport.
Yes.
So
water pour for my body like inside.
The body go cold.
But how you manage to get confidence in a UN staff
meeting? You are not prepared. You tell me
see where agent, all those crook agents are talking to you. And
you
get confidence.
I'm already in so country.
Man, I'm loving this interview. I say. Are you guys liking it?
When I came out of that embassy, my uncle was, he was expecting me to hug him.
Hug him.
Brother, they don't deny me.
So you are the real Dr. UN, huh?
So what are the doctor? Where is Doc?
Doctor.
Oh my goodness.
We don't see that man until he left Lagos.
There are many like that in Nigeria. Mm. They are fake agents.
You know, somebody told me what I'm doing. I'm actually destroying their business, right? Because. Yeah. If people can learn to do things themselves, there is no job for the agents. You know what I mean?
Mm.
You can apply, she can apply, everybody can apply. Agents cannot make money. So they need, that is why in Africa, ignorance actually creates more problems. Because if you are ignorant, somebody has to fix your problem for you by taking money from you. You understand what I mean?
Yes.
I'm happy if you're watching this, I can assure you, I will not spoon feed you. I will empower you before you realize you start learning how to do things. And sometimes all you need is to just do one Google research. And then you get a result. And then you are encouraged to do another one. And before you realize, you begin learning how to do your own research. You feel so empowered. You can feel that anything at all you want, you can actually go online and look for it yourself. Right? Instead of somebody going to use a Microsoft Word, like he said, making you a United Nations staff when you yourself, you know, you are pumpkin cracker. You don't even know where United Nations is for Niger self, you know. But they don't dress you up like United Nations doctor. And the guy takes it to the embassy and he disappears on you. And you know, so they ask the question, say, so you are a UN staff? You never left the country before? That question is serious, who cares? Serious,
who cares? Your body could just cook.
I tell you.
Oh, this guy, he did.
He did for my passport. Yes.
Sure, now, one agent, we almost, you know, when I was doing my Canadian visa, I got to a time I needed an affidavit, and I didn't know how to go about it. I didn't have contacts, who to call, where to go and stuff. So I contacted a friend who said they know somebody. This guy came, I won't mention his name, man. That guy, don't scam people. Hey, the guy has more. He's also my countryman, and from my same tribe, the same tribe. He will even use the local language. The guy, oh my God, the guy, he has mouth.
Yeah.
Sweet mouth. The way he will dress, tucking nicely with his glasses. And sometimes he forgets to put on a good shoe. You watch his shoe, you can say that the shoe is disqualifying, you know. Yeah. This guy will run you. I've done visa for people. I've done visa for people. So one time I ask him, you yourself, have you had a visa to yourself before? So yeah, I said, can I see it? He went and he never came back.
You know, one thing they do is that they will take picture of visa from other people. Like when I was in Nigeria, I normally do visa for people.
Mm. So,
yes. Mm-hmm. During those times that I was getting denial from America, I did America for several people and they got it.
Mm.
But me myself, I was the.
They say that's how it works.
Yes.
You do for people, they will get it by you yourself.
Anytime I got visa for people, some of the agents will call me a lawyer fan, and they come. I won't see. They will just come. They want to take picture of that.
Then they go and use it to get clients.
Yes, cover the name and the picture. They will just be telling people, I just got this visa
for somebody. So they can get
clients. You can see the date. You can see everything.
We need to step up, guys. On this platform, we are encouraging you to learn whichever country you want to go to.
Sure.
Is it Europe? Is it US? Is it Korea? Is it?
Anywhere.
By the end of the day, you'll get that empowerment to do things yourself.
Yo.
We'll guide you. We'll coach you. But you're going to learn to do it yourself. And he said, D-Y-R, do your research on top of that. That's what he said. Did you like the Miss Dr. Yuen? Agency, you like that? But you know, Dr. Yuen is actually Dr. Shefu.
Yes.
But they won't turn him into Dr. Yuen. Eh? Oh, my goodness.
Your platform has been liberating.
Mm.
No one else have liberated. It is liberating a lot of persons.
People, people who are ready to learn.
Mm-hmm.
Because there are still some people who doesn't want to learn. I got message from somebody yesterday. When the lady asked me some question, I would just look at her. How come? This person know they listen at all.
Mm.
Was asking me, how can I get visa? How can I, if I have Canadian visa, how can I convert it to working visa? I was just looking. So you don't go through all the videos. You don't listen to what people are saying. You don't listen to what Choco Millionaire are saying. So I don't know why people don't want to spend their time to do research, to get vital information that will be something for them, will give them. But they prefer to be watching all this funny.
Oh, when you talk, they invest you. Mm.
They can spend the whole day watching Netflix, watching all these comedians,
and you know, and laugh over it.
Back then in the university, say, I've forgotten who said that. They say if you want to punish an African man,
put it in book, huh?
Give him book to read.
But we know they like read. Is right. So on this platform, we know they encourage that, you know, you must learn to do things. And it's easy. We will coach you. Remember, he did his own visa application. He's a subscriber on my page.
Mm.
How much does it cost to subscribe? $4, which is about $6 Canadian dollars.
Mm.
Huh? You know the amount of information you could get on that, or the kind of... Okay, fine. You don't do it. How about the free videos that are here? Aside from being a subscriber, the free videos. Yeah. At least use that one, even if you don't want to subscribe.
Some persons...
So many videos.
compiled a lot of information
from him, from his video. Yeah,
yes. I'm sure most of them must have been, maybe they are writing a book on that. They will be, go and sell it.
The people are doing it, actually. Sure, people are doing it, yeah.
You're giving out, you are giving out too much value, honestly. Anytime I see the alert on Facebook, I'm just switching it because I must learn something new. Mm-hmm. You learn something new every day.
Every day, sure.
You don't repeat. You don't come and repeat things that you have said before. Even if you do that, you also have a way of infusing new stuff
and again,
refer to the old video.
Old video.
No, it's liberating. It's mind blowing.
Sure.
We have learned a lot. Things that we normally thought were that we are impossible. It's not possible. How can you do this? I just from your video, I was able to discover that these things are actually can actually do this thing, can make these things happen.
Thank you. I really appreciate it.
And I've also encouraged my family members to
watch.
Thank you.
Follow you back to back.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
I know persons I wouldn't want to mention name. Before you do anything, you pay money. If on that same Facebook, you go pay. They will come put you for class. Then you begin the same thing.
The same information.
And they don't even have all the details.
Exactly. If they give it out like that, it's going to people will see the loophole and they wouldn't want to pay. But you give out everything. You give
so some
wrong.
People don't. You some people may not like what I'm doing because I'm giving out too much.
Yes.
But I don't see why I should monetize it because it's free.
I said something yesterday when I came. I said, why? I asked him a question. I said, why are you so selfless with the way you help people, the information you give out there? It's unbelievable. You just do it with passion. With so much passion. And when you're talking, I can see the that pain. Maybe because of your experience back home. You want people to just learn.
Poverty tried to steal my joy. It actually stole it. So that is what drives me to do what I do. If I have the power, to be honest, if I have the power, I will banish poverty and put chains on poverty. Right? Because poverty is one of the tools or the weapons that the enemy uses to destroy lives. That is why I'm just passionate about wanting to see my people. Look, legit, I want to just see people succeed. Because I know when you succeed, your children can succeed.
Exactly, sir.
When you succeed, your wife is okay. When your children also many people will succeed. That is how the ripple effect goes. But when one man's destiny is cut off, it has a ripple effect. It goes down, and this is an area that the devil actually really gets us. He impoverishes us so that it gets to a point we don't even believe in God anymore because of our poverty, and we don't even believe in our own self. And so there are some human beings walking, they have no self-esteem, they don't even value their life. See,
about this thing you just talk about self-esteem, I watched one of your video where you talk about one mark on your leg.
Yeah, on my leg. Yeah.
Yes. You talk that for a very long time, you don't want people to see it.
Yeah.
When I watched that video, that day, something changed in my life because you can see my...
You wear that a lot.
Every time. But because of that day, for like 3 months, I stopped using this face.
Amen. Exactly.
Because of that, you know, because sometimes I feel like, oh man, this thing don't make sense.
You need to be. You understand?
So, but when I saw that video, I just sit down and I'm like, what did happen? No, I need to love myself the way God created.
You have to love yourself.
That from that, I don't care. Sometimes I forgot about the car. I don't care. But before every day, if I want to go anywhere,
you wear your car. Just because I was left esteem, and that is it. And for every human being, the moment you start losing the value for the worth of your own life, you start having that mind that you don't value your own side, that is actually when you begin going down like that.
Your value is
Your value is just good depreciation. And it gets to a point, you don't even mind losing the life.
100%.
Some people, for anybody that decides to say, it is over, I don't want to live this life anymore, they have actually gotten to the lowest point of self-esteem.
Yes.
And the devil has a way of taking each and every one of us there. He tests each and some people, he's testing them through marriage.
Yes.
That the marriage is not working to the point that they have become so useless. That's how they feel.
Yes.
They feel that they are failures. They feel that they are not woman enough. Somebody is probably watching this video. They cannot have a child, or they've been trying to have a child. They cannot, and they look at other people giving a child, and they look at themselves. They talk themselves down that they are not woman enough, or they were not created good enough, whole enough. A man is watching. Has been trying to conceive, trying. No, watch other men. People sometimes will use words to kill you by telling you you are a barren man, you are an impotent man, and we believe these things, and then we look, and then we just give up on ourselves that we are useless. You know, some of the words that our teachers will say to us, you are good for nothing, you cannot do something, and we believe them, and then it actually makes the child, destroy the child for the rest of his life.
Sure.
It's because this thing sticks in your mind. Some of the words that our parents even say to us. So in my house, for example, look, there are some words my wife cannot use. If she uses it, I'll give her that stern look. Not on my child.
Yes.
You can't.
Yes.
It will be positive words throughout. You declare them.
Yes.
The child must grow up knowing that this is the kind of life. Even me, myself, as a father, never will I. In fact, nobody can use certain words on my children. You can never. I will never give you permission to say those things about my children. Yes. Why? Because these are words that create. He created this whole universe with speaking. And the things we believe destroy us. So you just watch it. If you're watching this video right now, have you ever felt so low in life? Just go back to those moments. You notice that you first start doubting yourself. The enemy is so good. He has a way of making you doubt yourself. Until he gets to a point you say you are not good enough. People, you have no idea the kind of things I said to my own self. I was ugly. Nobody should be. Look, even when I was starting this channel, the devil made me believe that nobody will listen to me.
Yeah.
Nobody will watch me. But isn't it funny? Look at how people are coming from different parts of the world just watching.
You see?
Because the devil's opinion about me must not become my reality.
Yeah.
It is up to me to determine that. That is why we need to control this space well. The things we believe about ourselves. Look, there are so many miracles God wants to do in your life right now.
Okay.
Not just because he wants you to just believe it. There are so many miracles that the first thing that needs to happen for those miracles to even start happening is for you to first believe in yourself. Do you believe in yourself that you deserve it? Even if you don't see the miracle happening today, it kickstarts the process of the miracle and the transformation. In the Bible, it is said that Jesus went to his own hometown and he wanted to do or perform a miracle. That day he could not do it. Not because Jesus lacked the power to do the miracle. The people he wanted to do it for, they didn't believe in it. Meaning they themselves doubted it. You doubted it. In the Bible, he said, look, because of their unbelief, on that day, he didn't do no miracle. You see, you remember the gentleman on the cross? Two of them, one on the right, one on the left. All he needed to do was to believe he was good enough to deserve that. He said, no. And if you say no, who can do things for you? If you don't believe you deserve it, how can you even get it? That is why your self-worth. Self-worth means, okay, guys, let me use this. I know we are talking about their story, but let me use this opportunity to just chip this in. Guys, there is something called your true value. Your true value is what you were created to be and all you could be. It's your true potential. Sometimes that one is not so easily seen by people. The actual value that we have of ourselves is based on self-perception and what people think about us. Yes. And many of us, we never come to that point of seeing all that we could be. In fact, me growing up, seeing all the people around me being poor, my family members being poor, uncles, aunties, everybody is poor. School that I went to, everybody is poor. Society, it got to a point I just also accepted that I am just like that.
Like them.
I had to come to the point where people like Les Brown, who lives in the U.S., this motivational speaker, Les Brown, had to remind me that, look, there is greatness in you.
Yes.
Those words, oh my God, from Les Brown, it pierced my heart. It pierced my heart. Said there is greatness in you. You have to unleash it. And it was those words that actually made me start going back to the Bible to start reading what has God said about me. Say, before you were formed, the plans I have for you are great. Oh, the plans are so great. Eyes have not even seen it. Ears have not. But many of us will never say, fearfully made, wonderfully made. Many of us will never believe this because we can't see it. We can't see it. Just look back. The woman you married today, do you remember when we were dating her? You see, all you saw was just single lady walking around. But some people don't have the eyes to see what she could be. That woman was not just a single woman. That is a mother of children. Not just a young teenager with body. A beautiful woman that could become your queen. But if you don't have the eyes, you can't see it. And this kind of eyes that I'm talking about for seeing things for what it could be is what a lot of us miss. Do you know when I buy my properties in real estate, some people look at it and they downplay. They say, what is this thing this guy is buying? Shark. It's not that. They never can see. But before I buy, I already have the eye to see what it could be. Yeah. I want you to go back and watch my real estate videos. Before I start, I always tell you what I'm going to do with it.
You have a blueprint.
You need to.
In your mind, yes.
For you to get to that next level, you need to have the eye of seeing things for what they could be.
Yes.
If you cannot see things for what they could be, you cannot even take steps. So before we bought this place, if you've been watching this video, you know this place was not like this. But the vision was there. We know what it could be. Many of us, we don't know what our life could be. We think where we are is our final destination. If I had believed every single thing the devil told me or those negative voices was telling me, I wouldn't be here today.
Yes.
I didn't think I deserved to ever own a car. I didn't think I even deserved to sit in a plane. I didn't even think I deserved to even have a master's degree. I didn't even think I should even marry at some point and do wedding because in my family, nobody had done that at that time. Nobody had done wedding. All we know is that somebody gives birth to somebody, somebody gives birth to somebody, you know? So how could me be thinking of wedding? Man, you must be seeing greater things, so.
Yes.
And I want to tell you this. If you think about it, then it is possible. If it ever comes into your mind that you could do this, then know that it is possible.
As a man thinketh.
You see that? As a man thinketh, so will his life be. All right. Guys, thank you for sharing all of that. I know you guys are new in Canada. We're going to be, the timing is just a little bit cold, but we're hoping to get some nice moments here and there.
Okay.
And you just came this morning. You've slept one night. And feel free to spend some few days here. You can see this place has been all set up already. Yes. Do you like this place so far? This apartment?
When I came in here, I'm like, why have I been spending so much money? Paying for hotel. I could have maybe paid some, because you told me
the
amount of this. It would have been better.
It would have been way cheaper.
The hotel is just like an enclosure. A cubicle. You just stay in, you be moving in one very place. You just move around. There's no kitchen. But here,
when he came and I showed you that there is kitchen, you know,
I was mad.
When he came and I showed him that there is a whole kitchen, living room with chairs and everything, and this is where he could have been and all of that, he was like, wow, 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 you know. And then he started saying that if he knew this earlier, he could have actually, but it's all good. At least he's still here, so feel free to spend some days. No need to pay for it, just crash here and let's have fun. And
you're wonderful. I don't know how to say it, but believe me, I think you're already making your own mark. You understand? You're imparting life irrespective of country or where you come from. You're just, you yesterday, you just connected with me like we've known for years, and you give me food, drink, fruits. I'm like, what kind of a man is this? You know, and you even had a chat with my wife. We talked for long.
With your wife, we chatted, video call.
You're just so selfless. And believe me, you're one of a kind. Believe me, it's when I entered last night, I just dropped in tears. I'm like, God, you've been showing me favor. and grace. I told him how I came to this
place. This man is a miracle man. Oh, I think the two of them are miracle men here. But let me tell you this man's story. Okay, so for him to move from where he was, which is in Toronto, to my place. In fact, he said he wanted to see me.
Yes.
His return ticket, he bought his return ticket to go back and work on his restaurant and stuff, blah, blah, blah. But the man said he wanted to see me. Me too, I talked to him on video call. I felt that any question he had, we could have just talked about it. This man insisted he would see me. He said, okay. And he also doesn't know around his credit card. It's not working. He only has cash. So, okay. Try booking an Uber from there. Uber is also a bit expensive from there coming here. I thought it was ridiculous. So I told him he could use the bus. So he should go to the train station and either use a train to come here or to use the bus. So on his way, going to the bus stop or the train station, he ran to somebody.
I went up, we visited Bramalay. Even when the Uber guy picked me up from the hotel, he started acting funny, the Indian guy, that he wants to pick up someone. I said, no, you can't pick up someone.
When you are
this is my first time, I don't know you. It's, please, sir, just take me.
And it's Uber, you are not supposed to pick somebody else up.
So. Please take me to the train station. Mm-hmm. The guy who booked the Uber, because I can't book Uber.
Your credit card was not working,
guy at the front desk. I said, please, help me. It's my first time. I don't even know who you want to pick.
Mm-hmm.
If I had maybe stayed about a month, 2 months here, it would have been easier for me to okay, pick up. If you want to be help anybody, help. So when he dropped me at Bramalay, I observed that people were using their card to, they would just enter the bus
and swipe it.
Swipe their card. I said, go, what do I do? I called him. I said, I don't know what to do. But I have some cash. So I walked up to one lady that was putting on a uniform, security uniform. I said, please, ma, it is my first time here. What do I do? How do I get around this bus? She said, okay, follow me. I followed her. She said, I pressed this bus and dream symbol. I clicked, touched it. She said, okay, put your money. Like, how?
Okay.
Is this an ATM? Uh-huh. I brought out $20 bill and put inside. It was 19.16 cents.
Mm-hmm.
So he said, okay, wait for your change and your ticket.
Yeah. Inside the bus,
inside that machine,
there was a machine there.
The ticket came down and my change, the cents.
Mm-hmm.
I just picked it up. I said, thank you, ma. She said, okay, go to 41. Five check count from 1, 2, 3. No, count from 8 down. You stay at 5. 41 is coming. Then the 41 is supposed to drop us at. We're supposed to alight at Dundas or something.
Dundas.
So
Dundas.
I was asking questions, but I said, please, sir. Help me, remind me whenever we get to Dundas.
You don't want to miss it. You don't want to miss your destination.
So I will be the ticket. So at some point I slipped off my wallet, my money fell down, it was just there. When I woke up, the whole thing was intact. I'm like, immediately I was like, Jesus, my wallet. I just saw it on the ground and picked it up. People were there, you know.
Nobody took your wallet.
A lady was making call. I was worried. She just saw how worried I was. I was so comfortable. Any small thing, I wake up and say, please, are we close to
that? Are we close to that? Yes. I was close to London.
She said, no, we're not there yet. So when we got there, she said, follow me.
The lady said, follow me.
This is London. Just follow me. I followed her. Okay. Saint Catherine. Yes, she said, follow me. We're going to say, where are you going to? I said, I'm going to Saint Catherine. I'm going to meet my friend. She said, okay, we're going to. Oh, that's where I stay too. I stay at Saint Catherine. I said, really? She said, okay, just hop in. That was what she said.
What are the chances that in Toronto, you meet somebody who is heading towards Niagara in the same city you're going to?
She said, just it's not.
The chances are like 0.0.
I said, to St. Catherine, just like that. She said, enter. Just enter inside.
And when you say enter, you mean the lady was offering you a private ride
yes
in her car. You were going to take a bus to come to me.
Yes. I was supposed to take a bus and come meet him.
Meet me.
My brother, this lady, this woman drove and she was angry, talking, gisting. She's also a...
She happens to be a Nigerian, an Igbo
woman. From her best day.
Madam Amaka, yes. God bless you. I actually spoke with you yesterday. God bless you.
So mm-hmm. he drove me, she was worried. She said, no, you need to connect with her. Because when I checked, the internet was off my phone, mm-hmm. no way to connect. And she said, no, that you need to connect with your friend. I'll make sure you connect with your friend before I leave you.
Mm-hmm.
So he drove me to
Toro.
Mm-hmm. Said,
okay, which is by St. Catharines.
Yeah, it's by mm-hmm. St. Catharines. She said, okay, how call your friend. I tried calling, there was no internet. Of course, we were communicating mm-hmm. through WhatsApp.
Mm-hmm.
I tried, no way. She said, okay, give me his number. We tried first time, he ended up voicing. The second time, he called and Mr. Chokora.
I picked up.
Asked him, that was, he said, your friend is here.
In Thorold.
And when Mr. Chokora said, okay, please, can you help us check Zoom, all those cabs
that we can use?
She obliged.
She obliged and then she called. I was surprised. I asked her to transfer you to a local taxi to bring you here, and she did that.
This woman booked a cab and waited for the cab guy to
come.
Even drove her before she
left. I need to go and look for her.
Yes.
I spoke with her yesterday and appreciated her. I look at it, a fellow Nigerian, he just randomly ran into a fellow Nigerian. What should have cost him about a couple of dollars to travel?
Yes.
Ended up getting a private ride for free from a stranger. Turns out to be a Nigerian. So the lesson you are getting here, you cannot paint everybody the same. You cannot say Nigerians are bad.
Yes.
Huh? Because this other man who is from Nigeria to Japan to, as you know, Mr. Number 12, approved. He also, when he came here, it was a Nigerian who offered him a place to crash in for the night, saving him hotel money.
I met him for the
first time.
Friday, I went to his house on Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
Then the man came out on Friday evening. I met him for the first time.
For the first time you're meeting
Very, very nice.
Offered you a place to crash.
Yes.
Saving you money.
Very nice man.
The point here is, guys, we cannot, look, there are bad people among us.
Yes.
We cannot generalize.
Sure.
You cannot say that Ghanaians are not good. You cannot say that Cameroonians are not good. Kenyans are not good. Guys, try people. Give people a chance. There are bad people among us, but it is up to us to connect with the right people.
Yes, yes.
See the stories of generosity they are seeing. Are these not Africans who are trying to just be good human beings?
Yeah.
And there are good human beings around. It is up to us to genuinely seek people and have a discerning spirit. You see, he should have spent money. In fact, when he called me that he got a private ride, you know how many times I said, wow.
He was surprised.
Because the chances that you go to Dundas, and suddenly run into somebody who is using a private car from there, heading to the same place you are coming in Niagara, is 0.00 something. That's a chance.
Jesus.
Not just common like that. In fact, if you met somebody there, the person is also going to take a bus themselves to be coming with you on the same bus, maybe. But the first thing you have in a private car, say, hop in, let's go. Man. It feels like, for him and me, it felt like an angel was just sent to just pick him, and you know, that's how I see it.
When I arrived, immediately I arrived, cab guy dropped me.
Mm-hmm.
My spirit, I said to myself, I've come into the house of favor, and I will go with favor.
Amen. And look, interestingly, I so much agree with you. When you called me and we're doing video call, we're talking about different options, what you could do if you go to Nigeria and decide to come back, the opportunities here and stuff. And there were some things that it never clicked me to talk about in the video. But yesterday when you came,
God.
And then we ended up having your wife, who is heavily pregnant.
Yes.
The other time we were talking on video call, we couldn't get your wife. We were trying to do a three-way video call, but your wife was not.
Yes.
But the moment you showed up yesterday, your wife ended up being
away.
You know, and we ended up talking, and guess what I found? The wife is a super scholar, academic, sharp.
Wow.
Man marry well. This man married well.
You're nice.
Woman is literally just about starting a PhD.
Yes.
In almighty Nigeria, say, hold on.
Oh,
said, how many years did it take you to do your master's? She said, five years. And you still did your master's in Nigeria. It took you 5 years. Master's that should have taken 1 year or maximum 2 years. Niger Star, 5 years, and you did it. I said, ma, it looks like you are already a PhD candidate. He said, I'm about to start a PhD. I said, ah. That's why I asked her the next question. Ma, do you mind if I ask you, what class did you get when you did your first degree? She said, I had a first class. First class in what? Psychology. I started looking somewhere. I said,
honestly, even in master's, the same thing.
You have first class in psychology. Even in master's too, your grades are super good. And she, you can tell, when I talk to her, I could tell the woman is just a scholar. She's very academic. Paper. Somebody who has been writing papers already. Wow. Yeah. See, so sometimes, when we were initially talking, this didn't even click me to tell, find out more about the wife. But it was when he came here, we're doing a video call, and I found out that the wife is overqualified to be getting a scholarship to come to Canada.
Yes. Wow.
You know, so now it leads to a whole new conversation of opportunities there. So sometimes God just has ways of doing things. He's the one that orchestrates everything, I tell you that. So guys, God richly bless you.
Thank you, sir.
I know many are your plans. The thing we all have in common is that we want to succeed.
Sure.
We have this survival instinct that we know that where we are is not where we are supposed to be. Sometimes God takes us through different journeys. Look at this man. See how far he's gone. Your story is something else. Like, you know, and as I'm talking to you right now, there are people who are on this kind of survivor mission.
Sure.
They just want to just succeed. They know. You know within you, don't you? You know within you where you are is not where you are supposed to be. You've been pushing. As I'm talking to you right now, somebody is hustling trying to go to Kuwait from maybe Africa. Somebody is hustling right now trying to go to South Africa, maybe from Nigeria. Somebody is also trying to go from Nigeria to Ghana. Somebody is also trying to move from Ghana to Sierra Leone. It's the same thing. Mm. We want to just survive and we want to succeed and thrive too. See, it will happen for you. I don't know when, but I want you to keep faith alive and back it with action. Back it with action. And keep connecting with people who are heading where you are heading.
Sure.
So that the journey becomes fun.
Yes.
You see where you want to go?
Sure.
People have already gone there.
Yeah. Mm.
There is nothing new under the sun.
Yes.
Look for those who have gone there already. Person with no road, you go follow him. No see, huh? Yeah, my brothers are here. We're going to have fun. I think my wife by now is probably getting some breakfast ready. And I hope it wasn't too cold for you when you slept.
No, it's I'm getting used to it.
You're getting used to it small, small. Sorry that we couldn't get you that medication when you went to...
No problem, I'm okay.
Yeah.
It's just that cough.
You've been coughing, the weather. Like yeah, sometimes the weather, when it changes like this, some people's immune system, maybe your immune system, you may be coughing and stuff like that. But you'll be fine.
Is it lovely? It's better to cough here than
Yeah, thank you. Now, I didn't say that. He said it's better to cough here than to. Because he knows when something happens, when you call ambulance. Ambulance will come and pick him up. So, you know. Anyway, guys, let me say this.
Okay.
So, it's not been easy for you to get hold of me on the phone.
I know, sir.
There are times you call so many times just trying to get hold of me.
Yeah.
The same with you. It's not been easy.
Yes, sir.
Is it deliberate that I don't pick calls?
No, it's not at all.
You're a super busy person.
But you never gave up. You kept calling and calling and calling until you got me.
Yes.
And you never got angry that I couldn't pick. No, you always knew that.
I understand the situation. Mm, it's not easy.
Yes.
In fact, as sometimes, we are talking right now, some people may be calling.
No, truly. Sometimes, this man know they work. That's what I've been thinking of. Because I'll just see a notification. I'll check time. This man know they work. Every time. Before you know, two videos, second video in a day. I know. So you are trying. You are trying. No.
Oh,
God will give you more strength and wisdom.
When you came, I was actually eating with you and walking.
Yes.
We were eating, but I was walking.
Yes.
My laptop was on my side, I was working and we were eating.
You're building a community. Soldier, in fact.
They say I didn't hit Africa. Some people they accuse me, say me, I didn't hit Africa.
No,
I want to
Liberating Africa. The best Lucky Dube said, I think the best way to liberate yourself is mental emancipation.
Mm-hmm.
You are changing people's mind. You're making, in fact, you're making people to begin to live their dream, begin to fulfill what towards achieving their goals in life.
Sure.
Believe me, that's what you're doing. And there is no investment greater than human
investment. Thank you, thank you. May God bless all of us.
Amen.
May we. The devil doesn't want us to succeed. The devil will shame.
Amen.
The devil will shame. Trust me. Well, we must succeed so others can be liberated, you know. Yeah, imagine if I didn't believe in myself, would I be here today?
No.
Would there be anybody under the sound of my voice by the grace of God, you see? So that is why, look.
Imagine the gap it would have created.
I'm telling you. So you looking at me right now, your destiny and your success must happen because there are so many people who are looking forward to you.
Yes.
If I didn't, just think about it this way. If I didn't break out, there will not be Choco Millionaire. Yes. There will not be you. That video that helped you get your visa, that you think it was me, wouldn't have happened.
Sure.
Yes.
So I'm telling you, it is in your best interest to succeed, because there are several hundreds of people whose whole destinies are connected to yours.
Sure. Yes. Sure.
You not succeeding is not just a failure to you, but it's a failure to so many people. Don't believe what the devil is telling you.
Sure.
Don't believe it. You are more than that. You are worth more than two birds or two sparrows. Remember that. Okay? It's hard to believe because the physical condition says no. You look around, nothing is working. No job interview, no work. You look around, nothing. No pocket. Pocket is dry. Your wife is leaving you. Your husband is, you know. But I want you to start looking deeper. That, remember, there is always night, and then there is what? Daytime. Today, as we are speaking right now, is daytime for us. Somebody in Australia, in India, it's night for them. No matter how long it is, your day will come.
Yes.
Your sunny day will come.
Yeah,
right?
Yes.
Darkness will come for just a short while, but your bright day will come. Believe in that. No condition.
It's permanent.
Even that problem you're going through, it will soon pass, like a Passover. Right? You got it?
Mm-hmm.
But bless you and thanks for watching. And he came with a conference visa.
Yeah.
Sorry, a conference through a conference, but it's the same visitor's visa.
Yes.
He didn't come with a conference. He came with a reason to just come and see Canada.
Yes.
And he started seeing Canada already. Yeah. When he finished, he will write a report and tell us what he found here. So this is Mr., you know, I know a comment that I saw earlier. Say, all these people who are here, they are on Japa mode.
Yeah,
Japa. I won't be able to speak. All I know is that one is going back to Nigeria to start
preparing
to launch his restaurant, and if God's will that he goes international, maybe you could go international too, to the glory of Africa.
Yeah.
Hmm?
Yeah.
This man too, he just came, we just meeting, so we're gonna be talking more to find out how many days he's gonna be here, what he's exploring. And if he finds opportunities, why not?
Yeah.
Why not? He has an amazing family. He has kids back home. He is also expecting a brand new baby. We wish him all the best. Don't you guys? You have a girl coming. A girl? So you got a boy, you got a girl. God bless that. And God bless your beautiful wife, Mama. Talking to you yesterday was amazing.
Yeah.
I cannot wait. Look, you just look so scholarly.
Yes.
And I'm happy he chose you.
Yes.
There's so many women. He chose you because you are special.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
I know. So,
really appreciate your time. Yes. Everything you have been doing for all of us, all over the world.
Honestly.
Not only people who are
to the world. You reach out to millions of people.
Thank you. Thank you.
I appreciate your selfless service. Thank you, sir.
God bless you.
May God and help you more.
Thank you. And he asked me a question yesterday. Why am I so selfless? I talked for about 30 minutes. In the end, I said, because of Christ. So those of you who care to know, for me, I've had a personal relationship with Christ that changed me. So if you think I'm too good, maybe you should try looking into Christ. Try looking into Christ. Remember, there's a difference between looking into him and knowing him. When you know him, you never remain the same. I can tell you that for sure.
Yes.
I go to church for how many years since I was a child? When it gets to that moment and you get to know Christ, when you know him, you'll never be the same more. I'm telling you for
sure.
A fact.
Yes. Sure.
You will never be the same. He doesn't change you just instantly. But by the time you realize, there is a whole new transformation. Me, the same me, the kind of sins I've committed in the past, me being like this, that people can say I'm good. Look, don't look at me and say I'm just, look into that man there. Even if you don't believe in you, just take time and just, you know, there are people who just read about him. There are people who really want to know him. When you meet him, you'll never be the same. That is a fact. Fact. Yes. You won't believe it until you experience him. Mm-hmm. All right, guys.
Thank you.
I think my wife has food or breakfast ready. So we're going to go upstairs. Let's end the video here, guys. And then I'm going to be spending time with my friends here. Sorry I couldn't show their face. The reason is that I just don't want to show. You know me, I respect people's privacy. In fact, I was the one who offered to them, you know, let's keep, not everybody watching may just be, you know, so let's just keep some things private, still share this story for people to get. And in case you are wondering, does this guy just talk to Nigerians and Ghanaians? No, I love human beings. I just love human beings. That's it. If I meet you from Jamaica, I love you the same way. Like my look, it's not supposed to be conditional. No, it's supposed to be unconditional love towards humans. Just because we are all humans. You see, I love white people, I love Caribbeans, I love Indians. You know me, if you watch my video, you can see it. But as much as you guys are watching and you are proud of me, you love me, when I also watch myself, I say, Christ, is this sacrifice that I'm making good enough? This is my body that I'm presenting as a living sacrifice. Is it true worship according to how you want it? Sometimes I feel short. But you guys look at me, you say, yeah, I'm doing well. I look at myself, I say, I'm feeling short. That's how this world is. I encourage you to just take some more action. God bless you. Thanks for watching Choco Millionaire and my partners here, my colleagues, senior hustlers, you know? My colleagues, senior hustlers. Let's take the chef upstairs and let's see if the chef can help us taste some food out there, right? We love all of you. Peace. If you think you like this video and you think this video is worth sharing, please share it, okay? And make the internet a better place with good content. God bless you. Have a good one. Bye-bye. All right.